Audience.
Fantastic. Thank you. Go ahead.
Okay. Thank you for the audience. So the title of my presentation is Expanding Preclinical and Histopathology Capabilities with MRI Technology, a Useful Tool for Preclinical Safety and Efficacy Evaluation. The webinar objective, the presentation addresses the practical application of compact MRI and will demonstrate the practical concept examples in the field of smart histology. The presentation will demonstrate how compact MRI technology can serve as an important adjunct to toxicologic pathology by non-destructively providing three-dimensional digital data sets, detailed morphological insights, and quantitative information. What I'm planning to show here is some practical application of MRI in toxicologic pathology, and the emphasis here is really practical, nothing sophisticated, mainstream applications that any technician and not just MRI expert can run. Presentation overview. I will begin with a brief introduction of MRI technology and terminology, followed by explaining the concept of MRI-based histology, then presenting various preclinical models, and conclude with live question and answer session. MRI technology and terminology. Magnetic resonance imaging technology has come a long way. It is smaller, less expensive, easier to use. For non-clinical applications, the MRI serves to quantify tissue alteration, monitor disease progression, and assess efficacy and response. I wanted to start with a quotation of how the leaders in the field of toxicologic pathology envision the future, citing as follows. Many toxicologic pathologists will likely spend less time at the microscope, but will be more heavily involved in early research activities such as imaging. Indeed, researchers are starting to understand the added value of these imaging techniques, and the tools are out there already. So really, the future is now. There are many different in vivo imaging modalities like PET, SPECT, optical imaging, ultrasound, and CT. But what is so special about MRI is that it sits in the very good spot in the middle. While PET can give only functional information with respect to specific metabolites, the CT can give only anatomical information. MRI can give both. There is some overlap in the information that these techniques provide, but basically, each modality has its strengths. So when possible, the best is to fuse between these techniques and take the most out of each one of them. Advantages of the MRI in toxicology. It is not invasive, permits longitudinal in vivo imaging to follow disease in the same animal, better statistics, less animal required. Can acquire numerous digital slices from wall fixed organs in any plane without destroying the specimen. High soft tissue contrast as well as good bone visualization provides a means to obtain quantitative data and provides complementary information to conventional pathology, better practice, safer drugs, products. The MRI had until now a psychological barrier due to expensive equipment, expensive maintenance, special facility required like shielded room, safety issues like no metal around, hard to operate and aimed for MR gurus only, which required high level of expertise. The benefits of the M-series compact MRI system is a quiet operation, low cost, no shielding required, normal lab safety, one day system setup, maintenance free design, no special staffing requirement, negligible running cost, and placed anywhere in the facility next to other imaging modality behind the barrier, benchtop, easy moved to different location. The MRI became even easier to use by no more complicated software, no more tons of parameters to optimize, just one touch MRI, ask, touch, and answer. I would like to introduce, in short, the MRI terminology. By changing the frequency, duration, timing of applied magnetic fields and radio frequency pulses, the MRI can provide what are basically MRI stains. Most common MRI stains type of contrast are the T1 and T2. Here, I'm demonstrating the T1 and T2 contrast stains. Various range of planes can be used, like the sagittal, axial, and coronal. MRI data can be presented as individual slices, and as you see in the present slide. MRI data can be presented as slice through animation. MRI data can be presented as data through 3D rendering. Here, I am presenting segmentation volume calculation for each organ. Let me introduce the concept of MRI histology. We define it either as MRI-based histology, or smart sections, or smart histology. I'm going now to demonstrate that the ex vivo MRI can be an excellent tool in preclinical efficacy and safety evaluation, helping to accurately localize the lesion, count the lesion, measure their volume, being an excellent means for the longitudinal in vivo follow-up of the lesions development in the same animal, and ultimately adding information about the homogeneity of the lesions. All scans were performed on a M-series compact MRI. For in vivo MRI, animals were anesthetized with isoflurane, heated, and physiological monitoring was used. For ex vivo MRI, the fixed samples were transferred from the fixative, like 10% buffered formalin, to fluorinert, and then returned to formalin. Preclinical models to be presented. I have selected to overview 6 models as follows: detection of preneoplastic lesions in the liver, toxicity follow-up in the kidneys, assessment of subcutaneous local tolerability, testing the efficacy of anti-cancer drug in brain tumor model, evaluating the efficacy of lung antifibrotic potential of a drug, and combining the compact MRI capacity in the assessment of cancerous potential of novel therapeutic stem cells. Model of preneoplastic lesions in the liver. The first model that I wish to share with you is the transgenic MDR mouse model, spontaneously developing liver's preneoplastic and neoplastic changes. As toxicologic pathologists, we know well that histopathology is useful to phenotypically characterize the altered foci. However, we lack a tool which will locate, count, and measure the volume of these foci in the entire hepatic tissue. In this slide, the abdominal organs are shown in a coronal scan of a living mouse. We can see that the in vivo MR helps us in easily detecting the pale altered foci in the liver, as you can see it on the left. After sacrificing the mouse and before performing histology, we can extract the intact liver and do an ex vivo MR scan. Analyzing the intact liver tissue, originally fixed in formalin, through the ex vivo MR enable us to locate, count, and measure the size of the altered foci. We see here the 3D rendering of the wall extracted liver with segmentation or highlighting of the altered foci. The data obtained by ex vivo MR includes quantitative information such as total number of foci present in the tissue, size of the foci, and ratio of the total volume of the altered foci to total liver volume. Each of the identified altered foci is tagged with different color for further histological trimming and evaluation. Histopathology evaluation validated the histological composition of each of the segmented foci. All lesions were diagnosed as focal fatty change, as you can see in the slide. In summary, the in vivo and ex vivo MR evaluation were effective in identifying the location and measuring the volume of local changes, potentially pre-neoplastic, in the liver. The in vivo MR would allow to follow the lesion's development over time. Model of acute renal injury. The model of acute renal injury secondary to acute rhabdomyolysis, which was induced by the intramuscular injection of 50% glycerol in mice. In vivo MRI scanning was done on days 0, 3, and 8, and just before terminal sacrifice on day 15. Subgroups of the animals were sacrificed after 3 and 15 days for ex vivo MR scanning and histopathology evaluation. In vivo MR on day 3 indicated that the kidneys of the glycerol injected mice diffuse pallor associated with loss of regional distinction was noted when compared to the control animal. Also, enlargement of the kidneys was observed, as you can see on the right. In vivo MR on day 0, 3, 8, and 15 enabled to identify the time-related change in the kidney over time, indicated the days of maximal damage, necrosis, on day 3, the day on which partial regeneration was noted on day 8, and when complete regeneration was present on day 15. Ex vivo MR of the kidneys from treated mouse on day 3 indicated diffuse pallor associated with loss of regional distinction when comparing to the control animal in which no regions are clearly identified. In the present slide, you can see the ex vivo MR of a kidney from a control animal in which all regions are clearly identified. This is nicely compared to the histology validating picture. In treated mice, the ex vivo MR on day 3 indicated diffuse pallor associated with loss of regional distinction, the MR view is nicely validated by histopathology characterized by cortical tubular necrosis and medullary tubular presence of hyaline cast. In conclusion, there was a complete concordance between the in vivo, ex vivo MR and histopathology, ultimately enabling by the use of in vivo MRI to follow up, searching for a trend of recovery from the original renal toxic damage without the need to sacrifice the animals, and by this saving the number of animals used in the study. Okay, I will do here a break and I will give to Martin the stage.
Fantastic. Thank you, Abraham. And thank you for that introduction and presenting the first two models. We're looking forward to the next four. And we'll just give you a moment to catch your breath. While you're doing that, we'd like to poll our audience and just ask two more questions. I will launch the poll now. And again, there are two questions as part of this poll. The first one is, we'd like to know what type of imaging or histological techniques you're currently using in your studies. And the first option is that you're following anatomical pathology longitudinally in vivo using imaging such as MRI, CT, PET, or ultrasound. That's option number one. Option number two is that you're not doing in vivo imaging currently. Gross anatomical examination prior to tissue harvest at the terminal endpoint is your current model. You're performing some type of imaging on harvested tissues prior to processing for conventional histology. You're performing only conventional histology is option number four. And then if there's an other, please select that and specify. Give you a moment to select your responses there. Question number two is part of this poll. We were curious to know if you'd consider adding MR histology to provide a more comprehensive 3D analysis to your current workflow of harvested tissue prior to processing for conventional histology. So the options are yes, you would. We can provide more information, perhaps. And again, we could discuss the specifics with you if you'd like to. Option number three is not at the moment. And perhaps you're just attending this webinar out of scientific curiosity. We'll just give you a few more moments to submit your responses here. We appreciate that they're fairly lengthy. Okay, and also I just wanted to remind you that we are going to run a Q&A session at the end of our talk. Please do select the Q&A icon at the bottom of your screen and submit any questions you may have for Dr. Niska. We're looking forward to answering those for you at the conclusion of our presentation. Okay, so with that said, Abraham, I'm going to allow you to continue your presentation. So go ahead whenever you're ready.
Thank you, Martin. Okay, the third model of testing local subcutaneous safety tolerability of a drug. In this model, a drug was administered continuously for 24 hours using infusion pumps attached to the back of pigs. The objective of the model was to test the feasibility of ex vivo MRI for locating and measuring the size of the subcutaneous toxic effect. Biopsies taken from the sites of subcutaneous injection were scanned by MRI. As can be clearly seen on the left, there is complete correlation between the form, the size and location of the affected areas when comparing to the ex vivo scans to the histopathology. Histopathology confirmed the areas of necrosis intermixed with unaffected normal fat tissue. The ex vivo MRI enabled the segmentation and exact volume measurement of the affected areas. In conclusion, the ex vivo MRI was effective in identifying the location and quantifying the extent of subcutaneous necrosis and inflammation caused by the test compound. We can measure the relative irritancy of different dose formulation applying the ex vivo MRI method on fixed tissue samples. Model for testing efficacy of anti-cancer drug. In the present model, glioma cells were stereotactically injected into the right brain hemisphere of mice with the objective on longitudinal growth follow-up. Ultimately, this model serves for testing the and comparing the efficacy of anti-cancer drugs. Longitudinal in vivo MR doing it on days 15, 17, and 20 enabled to demonstrate the time-related increase in the size of the tumor, as you can see in this slide. Ultimately, histopathology was performed to validate the nature of the alteration identified by the in vivo as well as ex vivo MR. In conclusion, the in vivo and ex vivo MR provided a way to follow the time-related growth of the induced tumor in the brain and to determine the volume of the tumor. This model demonstrates the utility of using MR for longitudinal studies and would be useful for testing the comparative efficacy of anti-cancer drugs. Model for testing efficacy of anti-fibrosis drug. In the present lung fibrosis model, a single intratracheal instillation of bleomycin into 6 weeks old rats was done. The objective was to validate the use of in vivo and ex vivo MR as a tool for following the temporal progression of the pathological process. Ultimately, this fibrosis measurement may serve as an objective tool to compare the efficacy of anti-fibrotic drugs. This is an axial scan at the level of the lungs. The normal lungs appears black because air does not allow good contrast. The pale regions, which you see at the bottom in the treated lungs, represent fibrotic tissue as well as inflammation. You can see it here, 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 and here. Using the ex vivo MR, significant pale areas are clearly demonstrated in the fibrotic lungs, as you can see here. In this slide, you can see the ex vivo segmentation of the fibrotic areas. This procedure enables the exact measurement of the fibrotic tissue volume in comparison to normal tissue. Using histopathology with Masson's trichrome staining, it was possible to validate the presence of fibrosis in the previously shown red segmented areas. In conclusion, our experiment demonstrated that the in vivo MR provides a great tool for longitudinal evaluation of pulmonary disease progression and regression. Based on this ability, this method can be used for testing the effectiveness of different therapeutic modalities and objectively compare their effectiveness. Model for testing the cancerous potential of stem cells. In this model, we used the compact MR for the assessment of tumorigenicity following intrathecal transplantation of stem cells in mice. The objective was to test the feasibility of compact MR to detect teratoma induction in the NOD SCID mouse model following intrathecal transplantation of human embryonic stem cells. This is the intended clinical route of administration. Mice were injected with the vehicle control or with the human embryonic stem cells at the intervertebral L5 to L6 groove. In vivo MR was performed at two intervals. Ex vivo analysis was performed as well. Using in vivo and ex vivo MRI, spinal teratoma was demonstrated, which correlated with histology. You see a comparison on the left, the MRI, the segmentation, and on the right, you see the histology and the ex vivo MRI. Using ex vivo MRI, here you can see the segmentation of the spinal teratoma appearing in red. Using in vivo and ex vivo MRI, a brain teratoma was demonstrated correlating with the histology, as you can see on the right. Using ex vivo MRI, the brain teratoma is demonstrated by segmentation. Histopathology confirmed the presence of malignant teratoma induced by the stem cells. In conclusion, the MRI technique can be used for time course observation for testing the carcinogenic potential of novel stem cells intended for clinical use. Our general conclusion from the model reviewed in my presentation is that the in vivo and ex vivo MRI were proved to be an excellent adjunct tool in the preclinical field when testing the efficacy and safety of drugs and other therapeutic modalities, helping in accurately localizing the lesion, count the number of the lesion, measure their volume, being an excellent means for the longitudinal in vivo follow-up of the lesion, the development in the same animal, and ultimately adding information about the homogeneity of the lesions. Let me add a comment concerning the regulatory perspective. I'm citing from Dr. Bob Marenpot's view concerning the future use of imaging data in conventional preclinical studies submission to the FDA. This view was stated in a recent publication in Toxicologic Pathology, Regulatory Forum Opinion Piece, Imaging Application in Toxicologic Pathology, Recommendation for Use in Regulatory Non-Clinical Toxicity Studies. And Dr. Marenpot states as follows. we just have to take the stance that imaging as an adjunct to conventional histopathology makes the histopathology that much better and allows for better sampling. The imaging also provided three-dimensional quantitative data. I suspect providing imaging along with conventional histopathology could have positive regulatory consequences. Once FDA starts getting that sort of information, it may evolve to become a desirable component of a submission. So let me conclude my presentation summary. I presented a brief introduction to MRI technology and terminology. I presented the concept of MR-based histology. I presented 6 preclinical models, and I presented conclusions with regulatory perspectives. Thank you so much. Martin?
Okay, fantastic. Thank you so much, Abraham. And we will begin our Q&A session. I'm just going to get set up over here, so bear with me a moment. And I'm also going to bring a colleague of mine, Ms. Tanya Coldheart, on audio to participate in the Q&A. So Tanya, are you there?
I am.
Fantastic. So just for the audience's benefit, Tanya is a team leader at Scintica Instrumentation, and I like to think of her as a technical guru when it comes to MR. So if there are any technical questions, we'll recruit Tanya to assist in answering those.
Perfect.
We do have lots of questions here, but certainly we'd appreciate more. So at any point in time, as I've stated previously, just submit your questions through the Q&A dialogue and we'll get to as many as possible. And we have plenty of time. Dr. Niska, thank you so much for that wonderful presentation. Okay, so the first question is, you mentioned in your seminar, Dr. Niska, that the tissues are transferred to FluorInert for the MR scanning. Do you envision any damage to the quality of the histology sections used at a later stage for histological validation?
Okay, thank you, Martin. From our experience, the use of the fluid, special fluid called FluorInert, to do the scanning and the MR scanning, and then transfer it back to 10% formalin should not affect at all the quality of the slides. So no damage at all.
Okay, fantastic.
Martin, there was actually a question relating to that. So maybe I can pose that question to Dr. Niska. Mm-hmm. It had to do with how we immobilize the samples when we do the scanning. So specifically the question was with regards to how the lungs are immobilized for scanning, but I presume others would like to know about some of the different organs as well. Abraham, if you'd like me to address it, I can, in terms of the capsules and the technology that was developed.
So maybe, Tanya, you will refer,
sure.
And I will add if, okay,
sure.
Please.
Yeah, so on the M-Series system that Dr. Niska has been talking about, there is an automated sample handling system. And within that, there's a cassette, basically, that the tissue would be placed into once it was fixed and then placed into the FluorInert. And there's little soft pedals within that, if you'd like. So you would place the sample within the capsule, fill it with the FluorInert, and the sample would be held by these soft pedals, which are designed to hold the tissue sample in place, however, not provide any further damage to that tissue during the imaging. But they do ensure that the tissue is stable throughout the imaging session. And then once the scanning is complete, there's an automated sample processing part, which would load the next cassette, which has the next sample contained. So it's it allows you to do multiple samples overnight, for example, without a technician intervening to load the next sample. You would simply pre-program the images you wanted to be acquired and then let it run over the night.
Yes, I completely agree with you, Tanya. Mm-hmm. And of course, what is nice, and I showed it, for example, in the case of the liver model, where we scan the liver, we tag the different nodules, and we give this information with this data to the technician, to the histology technician, and he knows exactly where to trim the tissue and prepare the slides for the pathologist.
Yeah. Perfect. Martin, I'll scan the rest of the questions. I know we had one that came through asking about, are there any publications or references that relate to the models that you discussed today? And do any of them relate specifically to the regulatory aspects of MR histology?
Yes. So we published in recent years about seven publications. Two of them were under the auspices of the regulatory affairs of toxicological pathology. Most of the publications were published in toxicologic pathology, but not only, also in toxicological sciences and neurotoxicology. And all the references are provided in the program of the webinar. If one of you have any questions, I will be very happy to answer.
Perfect.
So you can use it.
Yeah. So when we do, we'll make up a transcript from the question and answer session that we're doing right now. And we'll be sure to include the list of those references for people to be able to find them and review them as well. Another question coming in, for your histological MRI, do you use any MRI contrast agents? And I guess I'll expand on that because I do know the answer. Would you be able to use contrast agents when doing MR histology if you wanted to?
Please, Tonya.
Okay. So I know for the examples that Abraham presented today, those are just the native MRI images coming from the different samples. So using different imaging sequences, things like T1, T2 weighted, you can highlight the different structures within the sample. So for example, the kidney images where we can see the cortex and the medulla, those are inherent contrast differences between the tissue. Could you use contrast agents? Abraham, maybe you can help me with this, but I believe the answer would be yes. So either gadolinium or iron oxide nanoparticles would be possible. Yeah.
Yes, you can use the contrast agents, and it will not affect at all the quality later of the histology. Mm-hmm. And as you see all the time, we are emphasizing the need to do the validation, because the pathologists are not going out of business, but on the contrary, it just helped them to do, let's say, more accurate job in identifying all lesions that should be checked by histology.
Yeah, when I first started to learn about MR histology, my thought was, is it going to replace histology? And Abraham, to your point, exactly, it's not. It's a complementary imaging technology to that, so that when doing toxicological studies, conventionally, if you're taking 3 or 6 samples within a tissue looking for lesions, some may be missed because there may be few within the organ. Where with MR histology, you're taking that full organ and generating an entire 3-dimensional image where you can locate and identify the lesions, as Dr. Niska showed, and then guide your sections based on those and confirm the pathology that's present in the tissue. So that's where the two technologies become very complementary to one another and help do better assessment and efficacy evaluations.
Let me emphasize here, for example, the last model, which I talked about, the stem cells injected intrathecally, I'm sure all the audience participating in this webinar, they are aware of the recent last year's requirement to add more sections to the brain in order to make sure that we detect, let's say, or lesions or tumors, etc., in the brain or in the spinal cord. But still, even with that, we are using today 7 sections instead of previously using 3 sections in the brain, we are not 100% confident that we covered the entire brain. And especially the entire spinal cord, because it is just impossible to trim the entire spinal cord. And it is clear that by the using this MR, ex vivo MR, you can exactly locate the where are the tumors, where are the lesions, and then direct the histology technician to trim in that site. So by all means, it is more accurate work. And I refer you to one of our publications published in neurotoxicology, where we are expanding about this issue.
Great, and again, we'll include that link or the citation in the transcript here. There are a number of questions kind of combining some questions about the technology. So Abraham, I will take these ones. And the first one is asking what companies manufacture this compact MRI system. And I know on one of Abraham's initial slides, and you can see the name here on the last slide, is Aspect Imaging. So this is a company that does the manufacturing. We're here at Scintica Instrumentation. We work to distribute that system here within North America and Europe as well. And so we're more than happy to answer any questions that you have about the specific technology. Another question about the system is what Tesla does it operate at, or field strength, and that would be 1 Tesla. And where that becomes really important is if you are using a contrast agent such as gadolinium, there's a number of papers that show a stronger sensitivity to the gadolinium concentration at lower fields, so 1 Tesla, compared to higher fields such as 7 Tesla. And we talked a little bit about that in the last webinar that I presented on the technology itself. And so you would have actually increased sensitivity working at that field strength with gadolinium. The other question in combined here is, does it require liquid helium? And the unique thing about this system is that it is a permanent magnet. So it's a neodymium boron based magnet, which does not require any electricity to create the magnetic field. The field is always on, so it's not creating any heat. So there is no need for cryogens like helium, nor is there a need for any liquid cooling, which some of the other superconducting magnets in the field would require. So it's actually quite simple to site within an existing laboratory, and all the shielding is contained within the walls of the magnet. So the 5 Gauss line, which is the line within which someone with a pacemaker, for example, wouldn't want to be, is just less than 1 meter from the edge of the magnet, depending on the size of the magnet you're working with. So again, if you've got questions about that, you can reach out to myself or anyone here at Scintica Instrumentation, and we're happy to answer questions. There's also questions regarding the maximum size of a tissue which could fit within the MRI. So there are 2 different sized magnets. One is going to be good for using with mice, and then the other one is up to a large rat. And so those can do whole body images. It depends really on the coil that you're working with. And so for those MR histology capsules that I was talking about, there is a specific coil that those fit very tightly within, and that's going to give you the best signal to noise and therefore the best image possible. However, if your sample's bigger than that and you want to scan it ex vivo, you would simply choose a larger coil. At that, you would probably start putting your sample into a Falcon tube, for example, so it's contained within the foreigner, like within the smaller capsules, and simply use a larger coil to be able to accommodate the tissue that you're working with. So that was a question about ex vivo. There is a question about in vivo, how large of a brain could be studied in vivo within this type of magnet. And again, that's going to be on the order of a large rat-sized animal. And I say rat, it can be similar species with similar sized heads. And there are brain-specific coils that are used to be able to accommodate that. So if, for example, it was maybe a guinea pig that may have a larger body, but the head would still fit within the brain coil, that should be able to be accommodated as well. There's another question here about could paraffin-embedded tissues be used in the MRI system? And Abraham, my understanding of that would be, unfortunately, no, because they would be completely dehydrated and we do need the protons there to acquire the signal, I believe is the is the response. And that's where the fluorinert comes into play and helps us to be able to do all of that imaging. I need to scan some more questions. There are questions here with regards to what's the highest achieved resolution and scan times for doing those images. And I know that at Duke, a whole rat brain was imaged. I want to say it was 80 micron isotropic resolution. And I can confirm this when we do the transcript. And the scan time was about 2.5 hours for that. And that was on a fixed sample. So again, having a scan time that long is less relevant simply because the animal doesn't need to be maintained under isoflurane for that amount of time. Obviously, if you're doing something in vivo, you want to limit the length of time that you're doing that image acquisition. But with heating and physiological monitoring, we do know how the animal's doing. Ex vivo, like I said, with that automatic sample handling, you can run a bunch of samples overnight without a technician there to interact with the system. So the scan times become less important because they're simply being done in the absence of anyone being present to deal with those samples.
Tanya, while you're scanning through the rest of the questions, Dr. Niska presented a slide that showed T1 and T2 stains, and you also mentioned it. Would you mind just elaborating on, for those that don't know, what the difference is between T1 and T2?
Sure, definitely. So for those that are more on the biology side or the histology side that don't have the background in MR physics, which I guess as a background, my background is not in MR physics either, but I've used the system quite extensively. And it is actually to be used, it can be used by those who don't have the background in MR because the sequences are optimized to provide really good contrast without a strong knowledge in the sequences. The way that I remember the difference between T1 and T2, there's certain sequence parameters and those are programmed by the software, but T1, you're going to see that the fat is going to appear brighter and the water is going to be darker, where on a T2 image, the water is going to appear bright while the fat appears darker typically. So if we're thinking back to that kidney image and we think about the performance of the kidney and what actions are taken in vivo, the medulla often appears brighter on a T2 image because it has more water content than the cortex, for example. Additionally, tumors often appear bright on a T2 weighted image. And so we're going to select that type of imaging acquisition to be able to highlight the contrast in the pathology that we want to be able to see within the tissue.
Perfect. Thank you.
You're welcome. We've covered most of the questions that were asked. There is one question here. Was there any quantitative validation of MR histology done, and what is the sensitivity and specificity of MR histology compared to histopathology?
Yes. I'm referring to our publications. For example, in the case of the subcutaneous model, where we were interested, first of all, to detect the location of the lesion induced by the, let's say, irritant drug. And then we wanted to measure the volume. So we reported it in the publication, the correlation between the size seen in the MR and the size measured by the histology on the slide. So definitely in all our models and in all the work that I'm doing, we always correlate between the histopathology, between the MR data and the histopathology if there is a in vivo, and ex vivo, and then the histology. And this is done in every of our publication.
Great. One other question. Can this technology be used to assess skeletal muscle regeneration and repair? And so I guess the question could be posed in vivo or ex vivo.
I personally didn't use it, but definitely I think we can try to see the sensitivity of to detect, let's say, fibrosis in the area of the muscle, and to see if there is a sufficient contrast between the normal skeletal muscle and the replacing degeneration and fibrosis due to the pathology, and to see if there is sufficient contrast. We just have to try to do it. I know that as I presented in the model of lung fibrosis, it was relatively easy to distinguish between areas that are unaffected in the lung to those areas where there is fibrosis.
Yeah, I've done a model in the hind limb of acute inflammation. So a topical chemical was applied and we were able to very clearly see the inflammation. Of course, again, as I was talking about with the T2 weighted image, inflammation is going to bring water to the area, and so it appears quite bright. And compare that to the other side of the contralateral side. And you're able to distinguish the muscles from that area, so you'd be very, very capable of making volume measurements on the muscle. So if you're looking for volume changes in muscle and growth in the muscle, I think that could be done. In terms of, to Dr. Niska's point of visualizing the fibrosis and being able to see changes in repair from that, it would simply be a matter of trying, but given that we can see fibrosis in other organs, it would make sense that it should be possible.
Okay, there are still a few more questions that I see come in, but I'm tempted to say, just to be respectful of everyone's time, that we wrap up right now. We've reached the 60-minute mark. So, Tanya, thank you so much for coming on to participate in the Q&A. Mm-hmm. That was very insightful. And a reminder, as I mentioned at the start, we have recorded this webinar, so we'll make the video available to all. And we will provide a written transcript of all the questions that we answered, as well as those that we have not yet answered. So Dr. Niska, I'd like to thank you for your presentation today. It was really marvelous. And to the audience, I trust we've been able to demonstrate, as stated at the beginning of our presentation, how compact MRI technology can serve as an important adjunct to toxicology and toxicologic pathology by non-destructively providing 3D imaging data, detailed morphological insights, and quantitative information. We've covered a limited amount of material today. I guess we certainly could have presented more. So I would encourage you all to reach out to us if you still have questions. We'd love to learn more about your specific application and how we can support your research. So with that, again, thank you, Dr. Niska. Thank you, Tanya. And thanks to all of you for taking time out of your day to attend our session. And we look forward to seeing you at another Scintica event. Have a great day.
Thank you.